Okay, so let us start.
Okay, we'll finish off the syllabus most probably by today. So hopefully we'll go by time and we'll finish off. First thing is we'll start with this numerical which we did last day. Okay, so this is where we ended our discussion, saying that the question was that considering a single branch rally fading signal which is having 20% chance of being 6 dB below some mean SNR threshold, determine the mean of the rally fading signal as reference to threshold. So this is what we actually have found out, that whenever we are trying to find this out, the first of the option or the first important thing that we have to consider is that here the probability is given to us. So the probability is given to us, so that probability is nothing but the probability of failure. Okay, so because here the question is 20% chance of being 6 dB below some mean SNR. So basically the instantaneous SNR is less than some threshold. Now since the threshold was not given, but it was given with respect to some dB difference, so what we did, we changed the 6 dB to linear scale and it came around 0.25 or 1/4. So we assume that gamma, if it is the threshold we are looking at, so that divided by 4 is the new reference that we have to consider. Keeping this reference, we already knew that this was the equation, because this was nothing but 1 minus, this came in because this is 1 minus e to the power minus x whole to the power m. This was a generic equation. So this x was nothing but the threshold divided by the average SNR. Now since the threshold in this case was gamma by 4, so we are looking at this as gamma by 4 and we have an average SNR over here. Finally, we concluded after calculating everything over here, taking ln and all those things, we came across an equation that with reference to threshold, we get a reference of, this is your reference, okay? This is your reference. So this is your reference voltage, SNR. This is your average SNR. So now you are taking the mean SNR with respect to or with reference to the threshold given, okay? So that is what the idea is. So this will be 0.5 dB that we have concluded. Now the second part, I just told you, but we haven't solved it, so maybe I can do it. So second part is find the likelihood that a branch, that a 2 branch, 3 branch or 4 branch selection diversity receiver will be 6 dB below the mean threshold. Okay. So what does that mean actually? That you have to find out the probability when you have m equals to 2, m equals to 3, m equals to 4. So what we are doing is, we now know, so 1 minus e to the power minus gamma by 4 divided by capital gamma whole to the power m. M we can consider it to be 2. Okay, so this is what we are doing. Now you can see this half, this is the brilliance of this problem, because you might find that the data are missing, but here you can see that this whole part, this whole segment is nothing but the given over here. So already this 1 minus e to the power whatever it is, this is already given as 0.2. We can equate that from the probability given. So what we can do is we can just substitute 0.2 over here, and now 2 is coming because of the number of branches. So we get this to the power 2. So we get now as an answer as 0.04 is the likelihood or the probability of having when the branches are having 2. So this is a probability of failure we can consider. Now if we go back to the third branch, so when we have 3 branches, nothing but 0.2 whole to the power 3. So you can see here if we do it, so it is 0.008, whereas when it is 4, so it is 0.0016. so these are the different set of probabilities or likelihood that with respect to the different branches. One thing to observe, the more we are increasing the number of branches, or that is the order of the diversity, the probability of failure is coming or going on reducing itself. So it was 0.4 earlier. Suppose this one, this is only when the probability was like for one branch, when there is no diversity, so it was around 0.2. now when it was used with two branches, it came down to 0.04. with three branches it is coming to 0.008, whereas for four branches coming around 0.0016. So the last question, based on your answer, is there a law of diminishing returns when diversity is used? So basically what he's asking is that when you are using a diversity, the probability of failure is coming down. Okay, it's a reduction of failure. That means on the other way, the success, probability of success is going on increasing. So the more you use the diversity, the probability of failure. Probability of failure is what? That the instantaneous SNR is below certain threshold. So that is being observed over here, that in this case, when we are using a fourth order diversity or the branches are four, then the probability of failure or the instantaneous SNR of each branch failing to reach the threshold is very, very minimal. That is what is being concluded over here. Clear with this problem, what we did. Okay, so this is the like the significance of using a diversity in practice. That is what being observed over why we are using the, what is the significance of improving or increasing the number of antennas at any point of time. So this is kind of the answer. So if you go on increasing 4, 5, 6, 7, it will go on reducing. But at some point of time, there will be no effect. Like even if you go on increasing the number of branches, it won't affect that much because there will be lots of zeros. Suppose it's like 0.2 to the power 6, suppose you do it. So there will be lots of zeros and then there will be some value. So it eventually it means the same. So eventually, even if you go on increasing the number of branches at certain point, you will reach a threshold that anyhow the probability of the failure won't change that much. Okay, so that's also quite observed. So this is what we finish off with, the derivation of selection diversity and its probability of failure. So this is a very important problem because it's giving us a lot of interesting observations. Okay. So please go through it. The detailed solution already I have uploaded in my login. So you can just go through it with that one also. So let us just see what happens with maximal ratio combining now. Okay? Because this is quite imperative that how maximal ratio is more better compared to selection diversity with respect to the instantaneous SNR calculation. Because if you remember, in case of selection diversity, we actually had a scenario, if I just go back to that equation, that we have that average or the mean SNR to be equal to average SNR multiplied by a factor where this is given by a 1 by k. So the more the antennas or more the number of branches we are considering, it will eventually not be that effective after a certain period. That's what I said. Because it's 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 5 and it will go on. So 1 by 20 suppose, it will not affect that much to the overall improvement. That is what makes MRC much better, because you will find that this average SNR or mean SNR will be given with a different set of observations. So let's see, this is a basic the diagram that we discussed last day, actually same thing. So here what we are doing is we'll just follow the some of the equation. Okay, we'll just try to compare with respect to selection diversity this one. So you can see here what we are doing is, see the signal voltage. Okay, so let me just go back. So you have the signal voltage on the ith branch. So we'll go one by one. So the voltage signals from each of m diversity branches are co-phased to provide the coherent voltage addition. Co-phase and sum was one of the important block within MRC which we have discussed last day. So if it is all coherent, then the signal voltage on the ith branch will be given by something like Ri is equal to alpha I. This alpha is the channel coefficient, which we all know, the complex channel coefficient, square root of Eb plus the noise Ni. So you can see here alpha is the channel amplitude, Ni is a real part of the complex Gaussian noise that we all know. So this is my signal voltage. Based on that, the difference in MRC was that there was a gain. There was a weighted gain. If you can remember the diagram, this G1, G2, Gn, these were all used by which we are trying to adjust it adaptively. There was a control from the output that were controlling those gains. So if I consider those gains, so you can see if each branch has a gain of Gi, okay, respectively. Now Gi can be many values, okay, depending on the output. So Gi, then the resulting signal envelope applied to the detector will be given by of nature of this. So you can see Ri was already there. So this is a signal voltage multiplied by this factor Gi. This was not there in selection diversity. This is where it differs, because this Gi is controlled by the output, how the output is coming. So this makes it, so it is summed up for all the m branches and it can be spread it in this way also, because Ri is nothing but this, so it can be given by this way. Now if I know this Rm, so this is the signal part. Ok Okay, so we have a noise part as well. So is it fine for all? Is it fine? We are trying to find out what is the mean SNR. We are just trying to find out, because here in maximum ratio combining, we are trying to have a summation somehow. Okay, so we will take that. So if I go about this, we are trying to express an equations of this nature. This yellow one is nothing but the selection diversity. In selection diversity, we have come across this. Okay, so what we did, we are taking a ratio of the signal to noise, same thing. Okay, just understand this, because don't write this one actually. So you can see SNR at the detector is given by a scenario. It is very similar to this, see, EB by N0. So EB by N0, same thing. But the only, and even the alpha is there, alpha is also there. But the only and the major factor is this GI part. Now this gain factor has a control of making this gamma m to vary or keeping it mostly constant, even if there is a variation at the output. This was missing, that's why I have given this one. Because this was in selection diversity, there is no G present over here. But this variable gain is present somewhere over here. Okay, so that is what makes it different. And finally, if I just, you don't have to write that one, just write down the SNR of MRC is given by this line. You can see, then again, if I consider the SNR of MRC, and if I substitute everything, like after going through the detailed value or the calculation, I can show you that as well. So, it's okay. I mean, I have uploaded the detailed solution for this. It's not that important. You can see that gamma MRC, this equation. Please see this one. You can see this is nothing but the average SNR which we observe in case of selection diversity. In selection diversity, this was gamma MRC is equal to capital gamma multiplied by 1 by k, something like that. But you can see here, with all the substitutions and the respective values, whatever we have, we are getting a scenario where it is a summation of gamma I. It's a summation of gamma I. What does that mean? It does mean that if we are calculating the average SNR for an MRC, this is nothing but the summation of instantaneous SNRs for each and every branches. So if maybe we can write like this. So this is where I'll write. So the significance of it. So I'll write over here. So this is SNR out of each diversity combiner is equal to sum of SNR in each branch. So this is quite significant, because if I consider the summation of gamma I, we are making sure that each and every branch, whatever be its instantaneous value, we are making those adjustments using the GA, the G part, the gain part. After that instantaneous SNR, we are just simply adding it up. Now you can see the part that I have written, SNR out of each diversity combiner is equal to sum of each branch. So whatever you are carrying, so the number of branches, if you have 4, if you have 5, if you have 6 branches, unlike to selection diversity, where the efficiency will not be achieved in that way, here actually when you go on increasing the number of branches, you are supposed to get a much finer value of gamma MRC. The more the branches you have, the better is the approximation for the gamma MRC. Because here it is not a 1 by gamma y. Yeah, please. Sorry, gamma? Yeah, this one, alpha square by EB square. This one? This one. Okay, this is what you are asking. Okay, this is nothing but this part. When you are looking at this, is we are taking it like you consider this one, this gamma MRC, as EB by N0 alpha square, right? Now alpha is a complex variable. Okay, now when you are looking at this alpha square, this part, when you are taking it as an like a mean of the all the alpha, because alpha will vary with the alpha I, right? Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. So it's like it's indicating as if that we are taking into account all the alphas, whatever is present, and we are taking a real component of it. So that is what we are observing over here. And now when you are doing a summation, you can see here again alpha I comes in. So it's the same way, it's a representation wise, it's just representing in that way, because the, when the summation comes in, it again becomes alpha I, because now the I will vary between a 1 to n. And then if you consider, I mean, like the detail of this is given in the notes, you just go through, because the calculation for this EB will again be given by the GI and the values, whatever we have observed. So it will come around this value. So the thing is that for more the number of branches we have, the more approximate value of gamma MRC we are getting. So that is why you can see the SNR out of each diversity combiner, okay, it's given over here. The SNR out of each combiner is simply the sum of SNR in each branch. Okay. So unlike to selection diversity, where the number of branches increase doesn't affect after a certain period of time to the overall throughput, here the more the number of branches you have, the better is the signal throughput you are getting. Okay. That too with the summation. And with the added advantage that even if one branch is having a less value, the other branch will compensate that. And we have a variable gain that will maintain the average SNR to be almost constant. Okay. So this is where the probability of failure will eventually come very low, even if you are using less number of attempts. So that's why, because in case of selection diversity, you are using multiple antennas, like 4 to 5, so that your probability of failure comes down. But in this case, it's already inbuilt such that the probability of failure is less. Now, if you use more number of antennas, which is a logical reason for diversity, the failure will eventually be diminished to very minimal proportion. That's why MRC is superior compared to selection and the rest of the other case. Anyway, selection is better than feedback or the other, like equal gain combiner and all. But except for this part, this is where it differs with respect to selection diversity. So this is all about, I think, this is also the derivation, like even for probability, the probability of failure that we have calculated in selection diversity, you can see this is the probability of failure, okay, this is the probability of failure once again, that the average SNR, because here the instantaneous SNR won't be there, we are taking an average of it, so the average SNR will be less than the threshold, so gamma is the threshold, so if I consider this one, so I'm looking at this equation. So I'm looking at this equation. So you can see gamma m is the average. So this gamma m is again given by that summation of gamma I. Okay. So this is again less than equal to some threshold is given by a little bit cumbersome, a bit complex equation. But ideally this failure, this is the probability of failure, will be sufficiently less compared to selection diversity. And more importantly, if I calculate the average SNR, gamma m prime, you remember this is now given as m into capital gamma. So we are looking at an equation this way, m into capital gamma, whereas in case of selection, if I write this as selection, it was like capital gamma multiplied by some factor 1 by k, where k was varying between 1 to n. So here, the more the number of antennas, the better is the average throughput. Am I understandable what I said? This part we did last day. We had this one, average SNR. So average SNR is also there here as well. Both of them are same. But in case of selection diversity, we had an equation where a factor was 1 by k, where k was varying between 1 to m. So more the number of diversity, the lesser is the effect on its on the overall average throughput. Whereas in this case, the more the number of m, because it's only a m, so the more the number of m or the number of branches, the better average value you are supposed to get, mean SNR value you are supposed to get. So this is what the observation or the difference with respect to selection diversity is what we are observing. Okay. So this is all about the two majorly discussed selection combining techniques. Along with that, you can actually, this is just a slide to give you a comparison or an equation with respect to MRC, EGC and selection. Okay. So you can see the left one and the box one is the given by the selection one. Okay. So Y selection is nothing but 1 by the K factor, whatever it is, multiplied by the capital gamma. Okay. You remember this is the one. Okay. So this capital gamma, this capital gamma can come up here. So it will be 1 by I summation something, and we have a capital gamma over here. That's what we discussed. MRC, we knew that this is M sigma or M gamma, and whereas for EGC it can be calculated with this type of a factor. Now you can see this is not directly multiplied by M. Somehow this is less inferior compared to MRC, but it is greater than the selection diversity. Because in case of, see this factor is not equal to M by any chance. It will have some less value. So it will be adding up to this capital gamma, but not as same as that of MRC. It will be a little inferior. That's what we said even while discussing equilibrium combiner. That it performs well, but little inferior compared to MRC, but again much better compared to feedback or selection. So this is just a comparison of these three. So that almost concludes the selection the space diversity and its different attributes. So we already had classified the different four sets of diversity. I told you that the space diversity, we have the frequency diversity, time diversity, and polarization or antenna diversity. So these are the four major classification of diversity. So we have done with the space diversity. In that we had four combining techniques: selection, feedback, MRC, and equal gain. So after finishing off with space diversity, now we'll discuss on little bit on frequency diversity as well, because this part is little easier compared to, because it's more theoretical aspect here. So you can see in feedback, in frequency diversity, what happens is the same information signal is transmitted and received simultaneously on two or more independent fading carrier frequency. Okay, so basically we are sending, in case of diversity, whatever it is, it's like we are repeating or we are sending the data over and over again. Now how you are sending it is different. One is case, the space diversity is the antennas are spaced at different positions and you are collecting all the data and you are segregating it, you are selecting it. In frequency diversity, what we are doing is that the idea is that the frequencies are separated by more than the coherence bandwidth. So if that happens, you remember the frequency selective fading property will happen. So that means each and every path will undergo a different set of fading. Because if each and every frequency, if each and every branch is going through a fading which is different, they are uncorrelated, because diversity, wherever it is supposed to be having a less correlation. The more they are correlated, the less is the chance of detecting it properly. Remember the first few slides I told you, the correlation would be very, very poor. It should be very less, not poor, it should be very less. So in this case also, the frequency diversity is applied in a way that the signals being transmitted at two different frequencies. Suppose you just imagine a scenario that you have two antennas and you are sending the same data. Now you remove those two antennas. Now you send the same data using two different frequency bands. Now those frequency bands are having a frequency or the bandwidth which is greater than the coherence bandwidth of the channel. Now as for frequency selectivity, if a signal is having the bandwidth greater than the channel than the coherence bandwidth, it will undergo coherence frequency selectivity, frequency selective fading. Now if they are getting in the fading, all these two fadings will have a non-correlation. Okay, so that's why they can be detected easily, that how the fading has happened and which one is poorer, which one is better. So I'm just I think you cannot visualize the thing. I'll just try to draw. Suppose I had this. Okay, this is already we had discussed. So we have two antennas and you are sending or maybe this is my transmitter. So you are sending the same data over the space and these two antennas are receiving that. This is what the space diversity is all about. Now what we are claiming is that we will have the same transmitter, but we will send it to F1 and F2, two frequency bands, and they will be received at the receiver. Now because this F1, or using this band such that it is greater than the coherence bandwidth of the channel. Now if that happens, you remember this diagram, you remember. So this was one coherence bandwidth, and suppose the signal bandwidth is something like this, or the signal bandwidth is something like this. So the portion which is within the coherence bandwidth, it won't undergo any fading, but the portion which is outside the coherence bandwidth, it will undergo fading. That was the concept for frequency selective fading. Now here what will happen for F1 and F2, two different sets of fading will happen. Now this F1 fading will be uncorrelated to F2. So at the receiver, we will detect which fading is poorer. If that happens, we will neglect that, we'll take the other one. So that is the basic idea behind frequency diversity. But the problem with this is that you are sparing a lot of bandwidth. you need a set of frequency bands which can be used as for diversity. So naturally for narrowband communication it won't be that suited, because again bandwidth is expensive, so you cannot really lose out bandwidth just because to achieve a diversity scheme. So it's not that a very profitable option. Okay, and you can see the wideband option, for when there is wideband option, we actually can deploy our frequency diversity scheme and we can go ahead with it. Same thing happens when we are discussing with time diversity, because in time diversity we will send the same data over two different time instances. Same thing, because frequency and the coherence bandwidth will be converted to coherence time. So just see what exactly time diversity. The signals representing the same information, now visualize the scenario, okay, the signals representing the same information are sent over the same channel at different times. So please note down this, it is at different time, because it's a time diversity that we are discussing. So again, a scenario is something like, if I draw it, so this is my transmitter, so the same information is sent over at T1, maybe this is sent over at T2, and this is being received at the receiver at some point of time. Now based on the T1 and T2 and its combination with coherence time, we will decide on which one is better and not. So you can see here, the basic idea is, if the time of delivering message should exceed the coherence time. So here it's coherence time. In frequency diversity, it was coherence bandwidth. Same, the observation is same, because here it will be fast fading. You remember, in case of, there were four classification of channel characteristics: frequency selective and flat fading. These were under coherence bandwidth. And slow and fast fading, which was there for with respect to coherence time. So here what will happen, there will be having a fast fading. Now again, with respect to that fast fading, they will be uncorrelated. So they will be detected, which one is having less fading. So it will be taken out. Okay. So the time diversity transmits repeatedly the information at different time spaces. And that in fact is one of the problem, because in that case what will happen, that the bandwidth efficiency is significantly worsened, because you are sending the redundant data once again and again and again. Okay. And then that might happen, that one data is being processed and by that time the same data overlaps with the same. That also might happen. So you can see signal is transmitted more than once, hence chance of fading at the receiver. So that's a disadvantage. Again, as I told you, that if you need to compare, okay, classify each and every diversity, you have to go through advantages and disadvantages. Okay. So this is one of the very common techniques being used in CDMA actually. And there is a specific technique called rake receiver that usually we are deploying with respect to time diversity. Okay, we'll see that rake receiver, because it's there in your syllabus. So you can see bandwidth must be very high to obtain the same data rate. You can see that the problem with frequency diversity as well as for time diversity is with bandwidth. That was not there with the space diversity. Space diversity never had a problem with bandwidth. But what will be the problem with space diversity or with respect to frequency and time? Why we are trying to at least discuss this diversities? Yes, that's the correct answer. When you are deploying a space diversity, you need first of all more number of antennas. Secondly, the antennas must be spaced properly. You remember the orthogonality principle, the frequencies should be such that they are spaced so that they are orthogonal in nature. In case of diversity also, if you are spacing the antennas at a specific distance, then only the diversity is achieved. Otherwise it's not. Now if suppose in cases where you don't have the luxury of space, you cannot deploy so many antennas after a certain space, what will you do? You will naturally go have to have a frequency or a time diversity based on your requirements. That's why we are studying this. Otherwise you might ask, like, sir, already space diversity is doing everything for us, why we are doing for frequency and time? But it depends on the application. Like I told you, the time diversity is very much useful for CDMA application. Okay, we'll see why. And also in frequency diversity, as I told you, for wideband application, you can actually have, when there is no scarcity of bands, you can have a deployment of this nature. No worry, you can just have one single antenna and you can go ahead with the diversity. So it depends on the application, how you are making it, how you are making an investment. So this is what the time diversity is all about. So this, we'll discuss on rake receiver now. This is a specific receiver that has been developed with respect to CDMA technique. and it's a very easy way, but very interesting way of doing it. Anyone knows rake? Why it's called rake receiver? Rake receiver is fine. Receiver anyway, we are doing it for the receiver. What is wet? What do you mean by rake? Do you know what is rake?
Okay, let me just